गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स.
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
ओके, सो इन आवर लास्ट क्लास वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द एप्लीकेशंस ऑफ एम्बियर सर्क्यूटल लॉ एंड वी ड्रॉ सम कंक्लूशंस बेस्ड ऑन द एम्बियर सर्क्यूटल लॉ एंड इट्स एप्लीकेशंस. इज इट क्लियर? ओके, देन व्हाट्स द एक्सप्रेशन फॉर मैग्नेटिक फील्ड ड्यू टू ए टोरॉइड? पुण्य, I can hear.
मैम,
Ah, yes. Okay.
मैग्नेटिक फील्ड ड्यू टू टोरॉइड इज इक्वल टू एन इनटू टू म्यू जीरो आई बाय टू पाई आर.
Very good. B is equal to mu zero toroid toroid mu zero n I divided by 2 pi r, or you can write mu zero n I. Okay. What about magnetic field due to a long solenoid? Aditya.
B is equal to mu zero n into I.
Mu zero n I. Okay, Achyut, what are the conclusion that we are drawn from the applications of this ambient circuit law?
Magnetic field at the point does not depend on the shape of the conductor, like ampere in loop. That means like all the three have B equal to mu zero I n. Then magnetic field is same at every point in the ampere in loop.
Okay.
Around the conductor, the shape of magnetic field lines are circular loop or concentric circles.
Okay. Anything? Anything more?
Yes, ma'am. Two more.
Okay. Continue.
Magnetic field direction of magnetic field lines can be identified with the help of Rankine thumbrule. Magnetic field produced in a conductor is directly proportional to current flowing through a conductor, but it is inversely proportional to distance from current source.
Okay, it is directly proportional to the current flowing through the conductor, but it is inversely proportional to the resistance. So not resistance, the radius or the distance. Okay, so we get one more factor that depends upon the strength of the magnetic field, that is distance. But this factor distance is inversely proportional to that of the strength of the magnetic field. If the distance increases, the strength of the magnetic field decreases. Okay, I hope it is clear. So today we are going to discuss another topic, that is magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. Magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. Actually, you can find this topic in your NCERT textbook, session 4.2.3. Okay, session 4.2.3, magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. In order to keep the continuity of the further derivations, I skip it there. Okay, so today we are going to discuss the next topic, magnetic force on a current carrying conductor.
Ma'am?
Yes?
I'm so did you change the sequence of the topics?
No change. I'm just keep the continuity of the next derivation. I want an expression from this topic. That is why I'm just skip it there. Okay. So the next topic that we are going to discuss today is magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. Magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. So in order to explain or derive the expression for magnetic force on a current carrying conductor, first of all, we consider a conductor. Consider a conductor. Consider a conductor of length L. And the area of cross section A. Consider a conductor of length L and the area of cross section A. let n be the number of charge particle present in the conductor. Let n be the number of charge particle present in the conductor. Let n be the number of charge particle present in the conductor. So here we consider a conductor of length L and area of cross section A. Let capital N be the number of charge particle present in the conductor. Then the force experienced by the charge particle, the magnetic force experienced by the charge particles that present in the conductor is given by, can you recall the force, magnetic force experienced by the charge particle when it is placed in a conductor? Yes, very good. Then the magnetic force experienced by the charge particle present in the conductor is given by F is equal to Q into V cross B. The force experienced by the charge particle when it is placed in a conductor is given by F is equal to Q into V cross B. Then by quantization of charge, we have Q is equal to, what is the equation for quantization of charge?
Ne.
Here we have capital N be the number of charge particles present in the conductor. So then by quantization of charge, we have Q is equal to Ne. So we can substitute the value of Q in equation 1. Therefore, the force experienced by the charge particle in a conductor is given by F is equal to, instead of this Q, we can write Ne.
Ma'am?
Yes.
Therefore,
after the equation 2, you can write, then the force experienced by the charge particle, then the force experienced by the charge particle in a conductor becomes F is equal to Ne into V cross B. Here, instead of this term Q, we substitute the quantization of charge Ne, because N is the number of charge particle present in the conductor. So it becomes F is equal to Ne into V cross B. Then the number of charge particles per unit volume is given by, what term is represents the number of charge per particles per unit volume? The number of charge particle per unit volume is given by the number density, small letter n. The number of charge particles per unit volume is given by the number density, small letter n. That is, capital N by volume is equal to small n. The number of charge particles per unit volume is given by the number density small n, or mathematically we can represent it as n divided by volume is equal to c small n. Then from this equation, can you form a relation for capital N? What about capital N? N by volume is equal to small n. Therefore, capital N is equal to, capital N is equal to
volume into small n.
Okay, volume into small n, or we can write small n into volume. So here, the number of particles per unit volume present in a conductor is represented by the number density, small letter n. From this equation, we can calculate the number of particles present in the conductor is given by small n into volume. Okay. Now, the volume of conductor is given by, the volume of conductor is given by, mathematically, we can calculate the volume of conductor using the equation area into length of the conductor. Area of cross-section into length of the conductor. Now, the volume of the conductor is given by area of cross-section into length of the conductor. That is, volume is equal to what about the area of cross section of the present conductor? What about the area of cross section of the given conductor?
A.
And the length of the conductor? A is the area and L. AL. I think we take it as capital L, right? You can take it as small l. Instead of capital L, we can consider it as small letter L. So in the figure also, you can make this correction. Small letter L. Small letter L be the length of the conductor. So the volume become A into L or AL. Therefore, capital N is equal to small n into volume. So instead of volume, we get the expression in terms of area and the length of conductor. So the capital letter N is equal to small letter n into volume. What is volume? So here the volume is equal to AL. Volume is equal to AL. Therefore, the number of particles present in the conductor N is equal to small n into volume. Instead of this volume, we can write this expression N into AL. NAL. Therefore, our expression for the force become therefore F is equal to, initially it is in the form of N E into V cross B. N E into V cross B. Now, instead of this N, we can substitute F is equal to, what is the equation for N? Small n A L E into V cross B. F is equal to N A L E into V cross B. Where this N A L is represents the number of particles present in a conductor. And by rearranging this equation, we get F is equal to N A V E. We can take this V term. So here we get the expression for forces. F is equal to N A L E into V cross B. Now we can rearrange the equation. Rearranging the equation, we get, by this term rearranging, I mean that we can take this velocity to outside and this term length L to inside. So the equation become F is equal to N A B E into L cross B. So by rearranging this equation, we get F is equal to N A B E into L cross B. Where this F represents the force experienced by the charged particle when it is placed in a conductor. And this small letter N represents the number of particles present per unit volume in a conductor. And A is the area of cross section. V is the velocity and E is the charge of the electron, L is the length of the conductor and B is the magnetic field. So here V represents the velocity, and since it is a conductor, this velocity is nothing, it is our drift velocity. Okay, since it is a conductor, the velocity V is the drift velocity. So we can write, can you recall what you mean by drift velocity? What is drift velocity?
Like moving an electron from negative to positive.
Yes, it is the velocity that is required by the electrons to drift through in a conductor. That is what is known as drift velocity. So here we are considering a conductor. Since it is a conductor, this velocity is nothing. It is our drift velocity. So the force become N A B D E into L cross B. This velocity is our drift velocity. Are you familiar with this term? What is this term represents? Yes. I, very good. In the last chapter, in chapter current electricity, we study a relation between current and a drift velocity, that is I is equal to A V D E N. So this term is represent our current that flowing through the conductor. F is equal to I into L cross B. So here we get F is equal to I into L cross B. This is the expression for the magnetic force on a conductor. the magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. Since the force is a vector quantity, we can represent it in terms of vector notation. Vector F is equal to I into vector L cross vector B. Or we can write F is equal to I L B sine theta. Since it is a cross product, we can represent it as F is equal to I L B sine theta. This is the expression for magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. Now let us see the force, the maximum and minimum force experienced by a current carrying conductor. Okay, suppose you imagine if theta, we know that theta is the angle between the length of the conductor and that of the magnetic field. If the theta is equal to zero, that is if the length of the conductor and that of the magnetic field are along the same direction, theta is equal to zero. Force is minimum. The force is minimum when theta is equal to zero. The force is minimum when theta is equal to zero. That is, the length of the conductor and the magnetic field are along the same direction. The force is minimum when theta is equal to zero. That is, the length of the conductor and magnetic field are along the same direction. Then we have F is equal to ILB sine zero. And we know that sine zero is equal to zero. So F is equal to zero. This is the minimum force acting on a current carrying conductor. The force experienced by a current carrying conductor is said to be minimum when the length of the conductor and that of the magnetic field are along the same direction. Force experienced or the magnetic force on a current carrying conductor is minimum when theta is equal to zero, that is, the length and the magnetic field are along the same direction. Then F is equal to ILB sine zero, or F is equal to zero. Similarly, the force experienced by the conductor is maximum. The magnetic force on a current carrying conductor is maximum. What is the condition for maximum force experienced by a current carrying conductor? Yes, very good. When theta is equal to 90 degree. When theta is equal to 90 degree. That is, the length and the magnetic field are perpendicular to each other. When the direction of length and that of the magnetic field are perpendicular to each other. Magnetic force on a current carrying conductor is maximum when theta is equal to 90 degree. That is, the direction of length and that of the magnetic field are mutually perpendicular to each other. Then the equation becomes F is equal to ILB sine 90. And we know that sine 90 is equal to 1. Therefore, F is equal to ILB. So the magnetic force on a current carrying conductor is maximum when the angle theta between the length of the conductor and that of the magnetic field is 90 degree, which implies if the length of the conductor and magnetic field is mutually perpendicular to each other, the magnetic force on a current carrying conductor is maximum. That is, F is equal to ILB. Is it clear? Okay. So here we are deriving an expression for magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. For that, we consider a conductor of length L, small letter L, and area of cross section A. Let N be the number of particles, capital letter N be the number of particles present in the conductor. Then the force experienced by the charged particle when it is placed in a conductor is given by F is equal to Q into V cross B, where Q is the charge, B is the velocity of the motion of the charged particle, and B is the magnetic field. Then by the quantization of charge, we have Q is equal to NE, where N is the number of particles present in the conductor, and this small letter E represents the charge of the electron. Therefore, the expression for force become F is equal to NE into V cross B. Instead of the term Q, here we are adding the quantization of charge. Q is equal to NE. So the expression for force become F is equal to NE into V cross B. But the number of particles present per unit volume of the conductor is represented by another term, that is what is known as N, number density. This small n is represents number density. So from this equation, we get an expression for capital N. Capital N is equal to small n into volume. And here we calculate the volume of conductor as area of the cross section of conductor and length of the conductor. So the volume become AL. Or we can write volume V is equal to AL. Instead of this volume, we can substitute the AL in the equation. Then it becomes F is equal to NALE into V cross V. Then in the next step, we just rearrange the terms. So it becomes F is equal to NAVE into L cross V. Since it is a conductor, this V represents the drift velocity VD. So the expression for force become F is equal to NAVDE into L cross B. And here this term represents the relation between current and the drift velocity. That is I is equal to AVDE into N. So instead of this term, here we can substitute I. So F is equal to I into L cross B. Since it is a vector form, we represent it in terms of vector quantity. Vector F is equal to I into vector L cross vector B. Since it is a vector cross product, here we take it as F is equal to ILB sine theta. And here we discuss the two conditions, whenever the force is maximum and whenever the force is minimum. The force is said to be minimum when theta is equal to zero, and the force is said to be maximum when theta is equal to 90 degree. Is it clear? Okay. So I hope this topic is clear to you. Is there any doubt? You can ask and clarify now itself. Is it clear to everybody? Clear. Okay. So now we can move to the next topic. Force between two parallel current carrying conductors. Force between two parallel current carrying conductors. Force between two parallel current carrying conductor. In order to derive this expression, we want an equation from this magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. That is why I am taking this topic now. So the force between two parallel current carrying conductor. So Before deriving the expression for force between current carrying conductor, we want to recall a rule, that is Fleming's left hand rule. Do you remember the Fleming's left hand rule? In order to calculate the direction of the magnetic field and that of the current, here we are using Fleming's left hand rule. So today we can recall the Fleming's left hand rule and we can derive the expression for force between two parallel current carrying conductors in our next class. So first of all, we can recall the Fleming's left hand rule. What is Fleming's left hand rule states? If you stretch, according to this rule, if you stretch the forefinger, thumb and the middle finger in a mutually perpendicular direction, such that the thumb shows the direction of force, forefinger shows the direction of magnetic field, and the middle finger shows the direction of current. So all of you first write the Fleming's left hand rule. Write the Fleming's left hand rule. The rule states that if you stretch the forefinger, thumb and middle finger, if you stretch the forefinger, thumb and middle finger of your left hand mutually perpendicular to each other, of your left hand in mutually perpendicular to each other, then forefinger gives the direction of magnetic field, then forefinger gives the direction of magnetic field thumb gives direction of force, thumb gives direction of force, and middle finger gives the direction of current, and middle finger gives the direction of current. According to Fleming's left hand rule, if you stretch the forefinger, thumb and middle finger of your left hand in a mutually perpendicular direction, such that thumb shows the direction of the force, forefinger shows the direction of magnetic field, and middle finger shows the direction of the current. Okay, I will give you a clue to remember all these terms. Actually, this Fleming's left hand rule, according to me, is a father mother child relationship. F for father. Father represents, that is our thumb. Thumb represents force. And this forefinger, the forefinger is mother. Mother represents magnetic field. So father, mother, child. C for child. Child represents the current. Okay. Actually, this is a small clue to remember all these terms. You don't need to be studied. Okay. So this is our Fleming's left hand rule. So we need this Fleming's left hand rule for the derivation of force between two parallel current carrying conductors. I am not taking this topic today because it is not finished. That's right. If you have any doubt in this rule, regarding this rule and that of the magnetic field, you can ask now itself. Magnetic force on a current carrying conductor, you can ask now itself. And have
Thank you, ma'am.